Hello everyone. The topic under discussion today is electrolysis. The objectives which we are going to meet in this lecture is what electrolysis is, what are the requirements for electrolysis, and how does electrolysis work. In my previous lecture, if you have watched the videos, you must know that we were talking about the metals, and we know that the metals that are reactive, present at the top of the reactivity series, they are very stable, they form very stable compounds. So it is not easy to reduce those metals with carbon and hydrogen. So we are using electrolysis to carry out their splitting or to reduce those metals. So to understand how we can do the extraction of the metals, we first need to understand the electrolysis. So let's start. Okay. Starting with the introduction, we know that the verbal meaning of electrolysis is electro means electricity, means electric current, and lysis means to break. So if we are using electricity to break a compound, then it is called as electrolysis. Now, what type of the compounds can be broken by using electricity? So they are not all type of compounds which we can break by using electricity, but they are very specific compounds like ionic compounds. And the condition is they should be in the molten or in the aqueous form. Why? What's the reason? If we recall our information regarding the bonding, we know that ionic compounds are made up of ions. And these ionic compounds are good conductors of electricity when they are in the dissolved or in the molten form. The reason is in that two states, in the molten or in the aqueous form, these ionic compounds split to form ions, and those ions are free to move. That's why the ionic compounds are good conductor of electricity in the form of aqueous or molten form. Covalent compounds cannot conduct electricity because they cannot be split as they are made up of molecules, not ions. So basically, how can we define electrolysis? We can define electrolysis that by the passage of direct current when we are splitting an ionic compound in the molten and the dissolved form. Dissolved means there must be a suitable solvent in which they have dissolved. So that results in a chemical reaction at electrodes and the separation of material. So there's a new term we have used, electrodes. So I'm going to explain what are electrodes and how can we carry out this whole process and what type of apparatus we are using. So getting back, so what is the electrolysis apparatus we are using? The name of this apparatus is electrolytic cell, and there are three main components of this electrolytic cell. If you see my cursor here, this is a battery which is called as external circuit. It acts as electron pump. These black color rods are the electrodes, which are made up of carbon or graphite. As we know that graphite is a good conductor of electricity, so these carbon or the graphite rods, they are acting as an inert electrode. So inert electrodes are those which do not interfere in the process of electrolysis. In my further lectures, I'll explain you the difference between the inert and the active electrode. For now, just that is enough for you to understand that inert electrodes are those which are unreactive and they do not interfere the process of electrolysis. And we have an ionic compound which is used as electrolyte. So when we have dissolved it or we have melted it, so the ions are free to move. So this electrolysis apparatus, which is called as electrolytic cell, may be comprising of the three main components, the battery, the electrodes, and electrolyte, is acting as a electrolytic cell or apparatus to carry out electrolysis. Now, what is the function? The function of the battery is acting as an electron pump that draws the electron away from the anode. So what is anode? What is cathode? These electrodes are named as anode and cathode. So anode is the positive terminal of the battery here. This one is anode. Where you see my cursor, this one is anode and this one is cathode. The labeling and the further description you are going to see in this later slides. So the positive terminal connected to the positive terminal of the battery, that electrode, is anode, and the electrode connected to the negative terminal of battery is cathode. And the ionic compound is an electrolyte that can that have free ions that allow the electricity to flow through it. It is molten or aqueous, and it is decomposed to form positive ions, which are called as cations, and negative ions, which are called as anions. And the examples are sulfuric acid, that can be molten sodium chloride or any other molten ionic compound like copper sulfate, or their aqueous solutions which are being made by dissolving them in water. And here these electrodes, anode is the positive and cathode is the negative terminal battery, and they are made up of carbon. And this battery, this is our electron pump that draws electron away from anode. Anode becomes the positively charged and cathode becomes the negatively charged. So electron enters the positive terminal of the battery here. The positive terminal of the battery, electron enters, because the negative ions who are coming here on the anode, they are giving away the electron. So these electrons are drawn by the battery from the positive and they go through the battery and goes to the negative terminal and come here, and this electrode becomes rich in electron, and this is cathode, where the positive ions which are deficient of electron are coming to take the electron. And this is how it works. Let's move further. So what is the requirement? If you need to define the electrolyte and direct current like the battery and everything, so the definitions are here. I'll read it for you. So electrolyte is a substance containing free ions which are carrier of the electric current in the electrolyte. And the DC supply, direct current supply, it provides electrical energy to carry out a non-spontaneous chemical reaction. So the electric energy, it is necessary to create or discharge the ions in the electrolyte. So external circuit is carried by electron in the external, electrical current is carried by the electrons in the external circuit. And what are the electrodes? Two electrodes. Electrode is an electrical conductor which provides the physical interface between the electrical current providing the energy and the electrolyte. So these were the requirements. And here if we talk about its working, then we know that the power supply, the electron, you see the direction of electron going from anode to cathode, electrolyte is here. So this is again a little bit clear picture of how the electrolytic cell is constructed and how it works. Now this is going to be a even better representation of the electrolytic cell. We see that here is a negative cathode, here is a positive anode. Anode is electron poor electrode. So what is happening? The negative ions are coming here and they are giving away, losing their electron to the electrode. So loss of electron is oxidation. So oxidation reaction is actually occurring at anode. So what happens? Anode is positive. So electrons are moving from here and drawn by the external battery, passing through the battery, and electron flow goes this way and comes here to cathode. Cathode is electron rich electrode, and here when there free electrons are present, so what will happen? The positive ion, the cation from the electrolyte, will move to cathode and will gain the electrons. So reduction will occur using these electrons. So cathode is a negative terminal because it is rich in electron. So electrolytic cell, electrochemical cell, in which a electric current is used to drive a non-spontaneous process. Spontaneous process is the one which takes place by itself and produces electrical electricity. So the chemical energy is converted to electrical energy, but in the non-spontaneous process, which cannot occur on its own, we need to provide the electric current for this reaction to take place. So what happens? This electrical energy is used to carry out the chemical reaction. Okay. Now, in the beginning of the lecture, I explained you that there are certain compounds like ionic compounds which can conduct electricity, and the condition is they should be melted or they should be dissolved in the aqueous solution. So, and I told you that covalent compounds do not conduct electricity. So, what is the specific terminologies? Those substances which are ionic compounds in the molten, the aqueous form, they conduct electricity, so they are called as electrolyte solutions. And those covalent compounds or any substance that does not conduct electricity in any state, those are called as non-electrolyte. So, it's clear from the picture, in the dissolved ions, the ions are free to move. So when electric current is applied, this chemical reaction occurs and the electrons flow from the external circuit and to carry out whatever the function, the electric current, like the glowing of the bulb or any electric thing we need to do. And in the dissolved form, sugar, which is a covalent compound, non-electrolyte, it is like present in the clusters of the molecules, so they don't have the free ions. That's why it doesn't conduct electricity. So if you are asked to write down the difference between electrolyte and non-electrolyte, so what you are going to write? Those ionic compounds, or those compounds, or those substances that conduct electricity in the aqueous or in the molten form, they are called as electrolyte. And those substances which do not conduct electricity in any state, in any condition, they are non-electrolyte. Examples are sulfur, sugar, distilled water, and organic compounds such as ethanol. So this was the difference between electrolyte and non-electrolyte. So what is the difference between the conduction of electricity in the metals and in the electrolytic solutions, like in the electrolytes? As we know that metals are good conductors of electricity, but the flow of electricity is because of the free ions, the free electrons, not the ions. But in case of electrolytic conductors, the flow of electricity takes place by the decomposition of the substance, as we have just discussed that ionic compounds are made up of ions. So in the electrolyte, the conduction of electricity is because of ions, but in metals, the conduction of electricity is because of free electrons. So there is no chemical reaction, there is no splitting of the compound, but only a physical change takes place. But here in the electrolyte, a chemical change takes place. So metals remain unchanged chemically, and the electrolyte chemically they are changed and split to form ions. And in case of the metals, the conduction of electricity decreases with increase in temperature. What's the reason? The reason is the positively charged ions start vibrating and provide the hindrance for the flowing electron. But in case of the electrolyte, the conduction of electricity increases with the time. So this is what you are going to write when you are asked about the difference of the electrical conduction by the metals and the graphite, and the electrolytic conduction by the electrolyte. So this is all about today. And soon I'm going to explain in my next video about the electrolysis of sodium chloride, copper sulfate, and the application. But for now, let's review this lecture. In today's lecture, we discussed about what electrolysis is, what apparatus we can use to carry out electrolysis, what is the function, and finally we talked about the difference between the electrolyte, non-electrolyte, and the difference of the electronic and electrolytic conduction. Hope this lecture is going to build your basic concepts about electrolysis. If you have any question, you can write in the comment section. I will answer. And I am going to see you soon with the further explanation of electrolysis. Thank you. Take care.